of the key cartel networks, if you wish, has been the Bilderberg Group. And Daniel Estulin is here today to share with us what he knows about this mysterious, faceless quango. Daniel's book has been one of the most influential tomes all about the Bilderbergs. So we really do here have with us today one of the key people with information on this. So I hope you're going to give a massive welcome to Daniel Estulin.
Thank you for coming. Can you hear me in the back? Okay. My name is Daniel Estulin. I'm the author of the book called The True Story of the Bilderberg Group. And we're going to be talking today about the secret society or this private organization called the Bilderbergers. What we're going to do is we're going to take the high ground on this. In other words, we're not going to talk about conspiracy theories. We're going to forget about the freaks and the quacks and the wackos and all the weirdos who follow this conspiracy nutty stuff. And when they talk to you, they show you a dollar bill and a pyramid and meaningfully look into your eyes and nod. I'm going to forget about that stuff, because the idea of me being here is to actually explain to you who these people are, how they work, and for you to be able to take this knowledge away and share it with others so that they understand. And the idea is, again, not to appeal to the crazies, because we already have all the crazies on our side. The idea is to get the normal people, the average people who work 9 to 5, go home, have family, and who don't really understand how things really work, and they would like to understand, and they would like for somebody to explain it to them, how societies, secret societies, private organizations, how they are interlocked and work towards a very common goal. It's a very old goal. Again, what today is called the Bilderberg Group or the Bilderberg Club already existed 800 years ago. It was called the Venetian Black Nobility. And today, Venetian Black Nobility also exists, and one of its key representatives is your stupid little shrinking Queen of England, which we're going to talk about that a little bit later on as well. Before we actually get into the presentation, what I want to do is I want to show you some of the characters who inhabit this strange parallel world of Bilderberg. Now, the idea of fighting these people, and this is a very principled opponent. You may not agree with their principles, but they're very, very principled. They know what they do, they know exactly why they're doing this, and they've also been doing this for a very, very long time. So the idea is that if you're going to fight these people, and I'm not sure you know who Bilderberg is, and that's one of the key reasons why they've been so successful over the years, they've been able to hide their identity so well behind so many other private institutions and think tanks, etc., is the idea of fighting these people is knowing who they are, educating yourself. And in this sense, you know, you're blessed because in London you have the British Museum, one of the key, you know, centers in the world of knowledge. So there's no reason or excuse at all for those of you who reside here not to spend a lot of your free time there educating yourself on what these people do and their historical background. Again, what today is called Bilderberg Group, 800 years ago, was called the Venetian Black Nobility. So what we're going to do is we're just going to go through the some of the photographs. All of these are my photographs from these private, very secret meetings, which I took with a very long lens from very far away. And just see for yourselves how many of these people you actually know, because again, when you hear some of these people make declarations and pronouncements in the press, you have to understand what they mean, because you also have to understand who these people are behind the curtain and what their real agenda is. Does that make sense? So let's see if you know who people are on this particular screen. I'm just going to go through them and tell you who they are, and just, you know, in your own heads, you see if you can figure it out. The woman with a very expensive haircut, that's Queen Beatrix of the Netherlands. She's the daughter of the founder of the Bilderberg Group, Prince Bernard. And the other guy, tall man, that's Count Etienne d'Avignon, the president of the Bilderberg Group and a very important member of the European nobility. That's David Rockefeller, in case you don't know, slobbering his soup. In this particular photograph taken in 2004 in Stresa in Italy, you have the two people looking at you. The man on his left, the bald guy, that's Henry Kravis, one of the major speculators of the last 25 years of KKR. To his left is his wife, Marie-José Kravis of Hudson Institute. So that's one of the key brainwashing institutes in the United States, interlocked with all the other institutes such as RAND and Hudson and Hoover. The one to her left, that's Richard Pearl. I'm sure you know who he is. The black man sitting with his back to us, that's Vernon Jordan of Lazard Frères Investment Bank, one of the key insider organizations in the Bilderberg Group, and the man who introduced Bill Clinton to the Bilderbergers back in 1991. That's Donald Graham, the president of the Washington Post, arriving in 2004. This is Martin Wolf of the Financial Times, many times Pulitzer Prize award-winning journalist, writing on economic affairs. Next time you read his columns, make sure you understand what you're reading, and his advice, make sure you understand what point of view it is being presented from. Again, this is Vernon Jordan. The woman to his left, that's Jessica Matthews, the president of Carnegie Foundation, Carnegie Endowment for Peace. And again, all of these organizations, the think tanks, foundations such as Ford Foundations, Carnegie, all of these organizations, they're all interlocked, all working together towards the same goal, NGOs, all of them are working together to the same objective. Because again, it's about money. If you want to understand how these people actually do their business from behind the scenes, you just have to follow the money. You have to understand how money works. That's what it's about. It's not about one world government, new world order. You know, if you've heard these terms, they're crap, they mean nothing. You know, to serious investigators, they mean nothing. It's not about one world order. It's not about one world government. There's been several one world orders going back to the Romans. It's about creating one world company limited based around corporations giving orders to governments. It's about destroying the very concept of nation-state republics, which is so dear to anybody who understands liberty, not democracy, because democracy is crap. You know, if you're talking about democracy, it's, you know, think back to Greece, Peloponnesian Wars. I mean, that's stupid. Democracy is stupid. It's about liberty, individual liberty, political liberty, liberty in all of its manifestations. This is Mr. Hubbard, a very important advisor to the Bush administration and also American Enterprise Institute member. See if you know any of these people. The guy at the front of the telephone, that's Richard Haass, the president of Council on Foreign Relations, which is interlocked with Bilderberg and interlocked with Trilateral Commission. The better known semi-private organizations, the nodes, let's say, the thinking nodes of more powerful secret societies which work from behind the scenes. The man directly behind them, the tall man, that's his name is Franco Bernabe, he's the vice president of Rothschild Europe. And the one to his left, that's again Henry Kravis of KKR. And the man at the very back with the glass, that's Richard Holbrooke, the six-time Nobel Peace nominee and the man who caused so much damage and so much havoc in the war in Yugoslavia. The man on the left in the foreground, that's Douglas Feith. This is the very interesting photograph because you have all the media people attending Bilderberg. The man on the left, that's Adrian Woolridge of The Economist. So next time you read The Economist, make sure again you understand what you're reading. The one two in the middle, that's Kagan. The one on the right is again Martin Wolf. The one behind him is Richard Haass. Bilderberg is a very interesting organization. About 120 members attend annually. Bilderberg basically is your former NATO alliance. And with the demise of the Soviet Union and breakup of the Warsaw Pact, a lot of the Eastern European nations have been incorporated as well. And even some of the Russian delegates also attend Bilderberger meetings. But again, they don't attend representing Russia, the nation. They represent because they are renegade forces, the fifth column, working against the interests of these nation states. So you have the presidents of every European nation, prime ministers, Prime Minister of Canada. The sitting president of the United States never attends because every second of his time is very much accounted for, but he sends all his minions to these meetings, and needless to say, these people don't attend as individual members. They attend representing other organizations. Aside from the presidents, you have, of course, leading bankers, top banking representatives of the biggest banking cartels in the world. You have International Monetary Fund, represented World Bank, Federal Reserve, Queen's Treasury. And aside from that, you have 40, 50 of the most important CEOs of the biggest corporations in the Western world, Coca-Cola, the IBMs, and Microsoft, they all attend as well. And all this one long, very big table, you have European commissioners, you also have all of the European royalty. Now, you may think that European royalty is just window dressing. Actually, they're the most important element in this entire equation, and we're going to, later on today, I'll explain to you exactly why they're such an important part of Bilderberg. And in fact, there wouldn't be Bilderberg had it not been for European royalty. And with them at this table, made for 120 people, 125 members, you have representatives of the press, and which is one of the reasons, you know, the CEOs, Washington Post, New York Times, Time Magazine, Wall Street Journal, all of them attend, which is one of the reasons now why none of this ever gets into the press. Now imagine if you had 120 of, you know, the Britain's biggest celebrities, you know, getting together in a room to talk about whatever they talk about. How many media people would you have outside wanting to know what these people are doing? We have the representatives of the most powerful corporations in the world, people who own most of the world's wealth, yet none of the people, none of the media is actually there to talk or to attend or to discuss or to cover what is being discussed. I'm the only Western journalist who actually attends these things and photographs, as you see these photographs taken from very, very far away. This is Henry de Castre, president of AXA Insurance Company. This is, you have Donald Graham, president of the Washington Post. To his left is the president of PepsiCola, Indra Nui. And on his right, you have, again, Marie-José Kravis of Hudson Institute. That was taken back in 2004. Well, the Irish attendees, obviously we know who this man is. Can anybody tell me? Huh? That's Gleason of AIB Bank. Okay, let's continue. Again, the president of the Bilderbergers, Etienne Davignon. This was taken back in 2004. The man on the left is John Edwards. At the time, he was just about to be chosen as the vice presidential candidate on the John Kerry ticket. All right, and the man to his left is, again, Richard Holbrooke. And when this picture came out in independent magazines across North America, New York Times had no choice but to actually admit on page 12 of one of their issues shortly after Bilderberg meeting ended that, yes, it's quite possible that this man, John Edwards, who attended incognito this meeting and gave a brilliant speech on the state of labor unions, was actually, you know, pre-selected at that meeting when Henry Kissinger, literally after the meeting ended, called Kerry and he said, John, I think we found you vice presidential candidate. Of course, I reported that in the press. So New York Times had no choice but to actually, you know, do the blocking for them and report that, yes, well, maybe it's, you know, quite possible that you might have been chosen. This is a security detail at these meetings. This is a hotel. You know, these people have a lot of taste. they might be sons of bitches, but they have a lot of taste. You know, five-star hotels, deluxe, luxury, you know, 2-3-star Michelin chefs, best food you can possibly. I mean, you know, there are a lot of people, lots of money, who don't know what to do with it. These people really do know what to do with it. Security forces will go quickly. This is, again, Richard Pearl. This is what happens when you get a little bit too close to them. Again, this is Wolfowitz in 2005 at the Bilderberg meeting. Peter Sutherland, big fat guy from Goldman Sachs. That's David Rockefeller. That's Timothy Geithner in 2005. And they were not very happy with me publishing this photograph in American publications, obviously. This is the what you have to deal with every time you get anywhere near Bilderberg meetings. You know, police forces block the area off about a mile across. This is the CIA, in case you're wondering. See, what they do, a lot of the attendees, because you have the inner circle of the attendees who actually... Some of the people like David Rockefeller and the Kissingers and the Brzezinskis who have been attending these meetings for generations, they know what's going on. But also a lot of the people who attend, they come for the weekend because they might be experts on, you know, on an amoeba that has something to do with genetically modified crop. Okay, they don't know that there's a structure behind Bilderberg conferences, so they just attend to talk about something they've been studying, you know, like a geek studying something for the last 25 years. And David Rockefeller and his company, they need this information to put their big, you know, giant puzzle together. But most of the attendees don't know that there is a structure. They're just too, you know, really happy to attend these meetings and to meet all these very, very wealthy people. So you see, the Mercedes-Benz has a letter B, which is obviously, you know, stands for Bilderberg. But you ask a lot of them, especially the security people, and they have no idea what B stands for. They don't know. They really don't know. You know, it sounds absolutely amazing, but they don't know. It's not a conspiracy at all. They just really don't know. You see, this is how far away. This is, you know, taken from with, you know, without a zoom. This is where I'm sitting on the other side of the lake. That's about a mile away. Okay, and you know, I can take it with my, you know, paparazzi lens, and actually get as close as you see some of the photographs. So, Charlie goes to show you, you know, in the world of, you know, I come from the world of counterintelligence. In the world of intelligence, there are no accidents. There are, you know, well-planned operations and badly planned operations. And the fact that I can sit a mile away. Okay, about, approximately. And take photographs of these people. It means that, you know, if I had a gun, I could probably kill them. Which means that they're really not that important. You see what I'm saying? Because if they're really important, I can tell because I know how it's done. You know, like you couldn't get anywhere near within like 3 or 4 miles because there's no gun that can actually shoot that far. Okay? So that's, you know, which if I have a camera, I can also have a gun. I can do the same thing. So Bilderberg is important to a certain point, but not really, really... that important. And just out of curiosity, how many of you have heard of the Bilderberg Group? Actually, oh shit, a lot of people actually have heard of the Bilderberg. That's pretty good. Anyway, let's start. In the world of international finance, there's those who steer the events and those who react to the events. While the latter are better known, the greater numbers, they seem to occupy the front pages of periodicals and television shows. The true power rests with the former. At the center of this You know, sits a group called the Bilderbergers. Now, the idea behind each and every one of the Bilderberg meetings is to create what they themselves call the aristocracy of purpose between the European and North American elites on the best ways to control the planet. In other words, the creation of giant cartels more powerful than any nation on Earth, destined to control the necessities and of every citizen of the planet Earth. People who have, over the years, attended Bilderberg conferences, you're looking at the presidents and prime ministers of every European nation, governments, heads of state, leaders of the World Bank, International Monetary Fund, you know, every member of Secretary General of NATO has obviously attended these conferences as well. What I'm going to do is I'm going to very, very quickly go over the structure of how these people actually work, which will give you an idea of their internal organization, and we're going to continue. There's 120 people. Meetings start on a Thursday morning. They go through Saturday afternoon. There's two meetings in the morning on Thursday and Friday, and two meetings in the afternoon. And on Saturday, there's just two early morning meetings. Now, 120 people don't sit in one room and talking about a particular subject. The subject matters are discussed about 6-7 months beforehand, and they're passed out to the delegates and to the people who are going to be attending these meetings, who actually have to prepare. There's no extemporaneous talking. They have to prepare their presentations. So what they do is they break up these 120 people into groups of 20, and they talk about the same subject from different points of view. And they look at it in the morning, and then in the afternoon session, what they do is they actually reach consensus. Nobody threatens anybody. Nobody tells anybody what to do. I mean, you hear a lot of, especially in conspiracy circles, people saying, well, they told, you know, Margaret Thatcher. Nobody tells anybody what to do. You know, it's, you have to be simpleton to actually believe that kind of stuff. What they do is they reach consensus, everybody working together the same goal, and which is one of the reasons why a lot of the times you have this incongruity of people who get invited, such as labor leaders, you know, or a guy who is, you know, vehemently anti-Bilderberg gets invited to the Bilderberg conference, and then suddenly he becomes, you know, he falls in love with Bilderberg, as was the case of one very famous anti-Bilderberg crusading journalist from Turkey. He said, you know, oh, this is amazing, I want to be back, you know. So like, they didn't threaten him, they didn't give him any money, they just, you know, showed him from their point of view there is actually advantages to actually form part of this group. And there are many, many advantages, because aside from the fact that you're rubbing shoulders with very important people, you also get access to information which most people don't have, and that's very obviously enticing for anybody. So speakers, they get to speak for 5 minutes, for 3 minutes, or for 1 minute, which is why you see that, you know, this is a cut out from a Swedish newspaper from 2001. The 1 minute speakers get to go first. What they do is they sit in alphabetical order. So 1 year, the A's sit in the front row and the Z's sit in the last row. The next year, they reverse and they change. Obviously, the Z's sit in the front. And Chatham House rules means that none of the information being presented there can be divulged to the public. And these are some of the attendees in 2001. You have John Kerry, you have Catherine Graham of the Washington Post. You have the British representatives, Peter Carrington, member of a very important noble family in England. You have Henry Kissinger, Conrad Black, now disgraced Conrad Black. So again, it's a very important organization. But Bilderberg isn't a conspiracy. It's not a society. There's no conspiracy known as the Bilderberg conspiracy, although a lot of people would like it to believe. There's no such thing as you know, a group of people sitting in a room, no matter how powerful they are, you know, holding hands, staring at a crystal ball, planning the world's domination. It just doesn't work this way in the real world, okay? It's literally a conspiracy of powerful people, a conspiracy of money. It's a meeting of people who represent a certain ideology. And again, that ideology is an ideology of one world government or new world order, terms which a lot of people very frivolously, you know, band around. It's not about that at all. It's about creating one world company limited. It's about corporations giving orders to governments. It's about creating financial structures which are more powerful than any government on earth. And in order to do this, what you have to do is you have to destroy every nation state republic, which is, again, one of the ideas about what we're doing today is the concept of critical thinking. Not only don't accept what I'm saying as, you know, as God's given truth, but also the idea of understanding, you know, that such things as cause and, you know, result. The result is easy to see. You have an explosion, people die. It's the cause that's very, very difficult to understand. And that's what you have to do. That's the job that you have to do when we leave this conference or this weekend, actually put all this information in to good use, meaning that not only do you understand what I'm saying and stop talking about, you know, one world government and showing people $1 bill and meaningfully, you know, saying, you know what I mean, but actually understanding where all this stuff comes from, understanding that, for example, in order to destroy nations, you have to destroy language, because language creates nation states, not the other way around. So when you have H.G. Wells, you know, that stupid degenerate, talking about 850-word basic English, he knows exactly what he's talking about. When you have the outcome-based education, which destroys, you know, the very premise of classical culture, the only culture worth anything on the planet, you have to understand why it is being done. So these are the kinds of things you have to question every element, not only question what the politicians are saying, because again, the politicians are simply not important. You know, David Rockefeller is not important. I know a lot of people think, you know, I talked to some really nice people yesterday, but you know, they think that David Rockefeller is the guy who runs this thing, or the Rothschilds, you know, but these people are nothing. They're dung, they're nothing. You know, in the world of really powerful people, they're nothing. The fact that you know David Rockefeller's name, you even know what he looks like, makes him really unimportant. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay, because really powerful people, you don't even know who they are. For example, one of the most powerful families in the world are the Venetian nobles who go by the name of Frescobaldis. The lineages of every European royal house comes from these people. You may know another very powerful family called the Astors because you know Hotel Astoria, okay? But you don't know the Frescobaldis. You may know the House of Habsburg-Lorraine, but you may not know the Braganzas. These are the people who have real wealth. And the reason you don't see them on the front pages of newspapers is because they don't have foundations and think tanks, you know, named after them, is because they're the real power behind the throne. Now, the reason people don't believe in secret societies controlling the world is, especially when you're talking to normal people. By normal people, I mean just average. Somebody who lives, has a normal life, job, mortgage, family, car, etc. Is that there is a Cartesian fantasy world in which the isolated intentions of some individuals and not the dynamics of social processes actually through the course of history as the movement of evolving ideas over successive generations cause all of these things to happen. What I'm trying to say again, it's not, you know, somebody told Margaret Thatcher to go and, you know, do, and she goes and does, and it's, you know, you understand what I'm saying, right? These are dynamic processes. These things, you know, take a long time to put together. It's not a, Bilderberg is a very young organization. I mean, they're first met in 1954. So how can somebody so young be so powerful? It can't. Again, you know, if there's a great expression in Russian. It's, you know, are you on friendly terms with your brain? If you are, then obviously these things, you know, you should understand that nobody 50 years young, you know, in the history of mankind, which spans thousands of years, can be powerful. Because that power has to come from somewhere. That power has to come from the social processes, which I'm talking about. It's not, again, the Cartesian fantasy world, you know, of one individual or group of individuals, and actually, which is one of the reasons it's so difficult for people to believe all this stuff. Because we tend to present it from a very simplistic point of view, and it's not. It can be explained historically, which is one of the reasons the New York Times of this world have never, ever, ever been able to discredit me, which is why I've sold 3.5 million copies of my book, because normal people say, you know, this guy makes sense. There's logic to all of this, historical logic, it makes sense, which is why we're going to listen to what he's saying. So, historically speaking, Bilderberg Organization was founded by this other society called the Martinist, or the Martinists, which is an esoteric secret society. And they, in fact, actually, you know, without missing a chain, Bilderbergs were founded by the Synarchists. Okay, Synarchist movement of vampires back in the 1920s. That's where the Synarchists came to. And the Synarchists were founded by the Martin Esoteric Secret Society back in the 1770s, okay, which was the answer, you know, to the advancements of the American Revolution. So again, historically, if you look at what's going on, you can explain where all of these organizations are coming from. You know, the Martinists, they were born as the antidote to what America was able to reach, you know, the first nation state, the first constitution, okay? And they founded the Synarchists, who are behind the Nazis, okay? And the Synarchists founded the Bilderbergers, whose roots are Nazi. So when you have all these individuals from The Economist and The Washington Post, and, you know, again, everybody knows that Bush family roots are Nazi roots. But what you have to understand that, again, these are insignificant individuals, very, very insignificant, just, you know, a grain in this machine. And this machine is very, very old. And what today is called Bilderberg, before they were, you know, synarchists, and before they were Martinists, they were the Venetian black nobility going back to the 13th century. And when that collapsed, you know, beginning with the collapse of the Bardi and the Peruzzi banking houses in 1345, which brought on the Black Death epidemic, which wiped out half of European population, okay? That gave rise to several other things which we have today, such as the idea of nation-state republics, which came as a result of a meeting which took place in 1439, 1440, between what I think is the greatest man in the history of the last 1,000 years, Cardinal Nicholas of Cusa. Have you ever heard of that man's name? But you've certainly heard of that, you know, stupid David Beckham, you know, and all his idiot wife, right? Oh, Tiger Woods and all of his girlfriends. I'm sure you can, like, point them out and, you know their histories. Do you understand how popular culture controls inadvertently? And as much as we'd like to think that we come to alternative view conferences when we, you know, we're different and we're hip, again, you know, if you're on friendly terms with your brains, you know, figure it out. Historically, all the stuff. It's, you know, so people who, you know, do their research by sitting in the living room eating an apple, watching television, and Googling words on their computer, that's not research. You know, there's some very useful information on, you know, if you Google stuff, but there's also a lot of crap. And it's done so because it's just, you know, such a wealth of information. You have to understand, you have to be discerning about this this kind of stuff. So again, you know, Bilderbergers, it's a medium of bringing together financial institutions, which are the world's most powerful and most predatory financial interests. And these are the financial interests that today threaten, you know, the freedom of the entire planet. And again, we'll talk a little bit later about that as well. Let's continue. What they do is, a funny thing about, you know, some of their tactics, modus operandi, is when they meet, they usually meet in small little towns about half an hour from, you know, big airport, you know, such as Milan or Munich. And this is from 2005, from Rotaheger, and this is a little, you know, local newspaper, very, very local, and this is the ad. And the reason they pulled this in so that the local residents, who most of the retirees, you know, they don't get scared and have heart attacks, and you have these big, you know, security guards with big guns walking around the town, you have David Rockefeller and his, you know, Bentley driving by and say, what the, you know? So actually there's an explanation. And what they say is all these retired, you know, people who once were very powerful but now are not, a meeting in a little town, they're just going to talk politics, talk, you know, show pictures of families and old war stories, and talk, there's nothing's going on, okay? And in fact, nothing is going on. But what's interesting about, this is Etienne d'Avignon, the president of Bilderberg, what's interesting about how these people work is, as I said, it's not a pyramidal structure. It's, you know, it's not, you know, the evil eye. I don't even know where this evil eye stuff comes from. You know, can somebody, like, explain it to me? You know, it's, when people show me a dollar bill and show me a pyramid, I really don't want to, you know, spoil their enthusiasm and explain to them the history of that. Because it has nothing to do at all with Bilderberger structures or Illuminati structures or powerful society structure. It's a very different thing. It's not a top of the pyramid. Again, it's a very logical thing if you just think about it for a second. If you have a pyramid, if you get lucky, you can chop the guy's head off if he's the top of the pyramid. Do you know what, am I, like, you know, explaining myself? Do you understand what I'm saying? It's the top of the pyramid. So the point is, again, it's not a pyramid. Okay, it's circles within circles. It's this, it's lateral, it's not top-down. The reason, again, it's not top-down, because if you take top-down as the head and the body, if somebody gets lucky enough and actually gets up the head, you can, you know, destroy the entire organization. So it's not top-down, it's lateral, which is why there's no one center, there's many nodes. So you have the Bilderbergers, you have the, you know, Trilateral Commission, you have Council of Foreign Relations, and then you have, you know, the think tanks and the foundations and the NGOs and other organizations, small or big, and all of them working together, it's this way, okay? So no matter where you chop, you'll never actually get it, because there's no center to chop, okay? There's no individual you can actually get at, okay? Because there's just so many nodes working together. And what happens basically is the decisions taken at one meeting get passed on to the other. I'm going to give you an example. You see, in January we have, you know, the World Economic Forum, Davos, and then in March the Trilateral Commission have their annual meeting, in April the Council for Relations meet, and in May, June the Bilderbergers have their annual meeting. September, International Monetary Fund, the World Bank meet for their annual meeting. Then in October, November, December, Trilateral Commission, they have their regional meetings, Americas, Europe, and Asia, thus trilateral. But nobody's leading this thing, okay? But the decisions taken at one basically affect the future of humanity over the next 10, 15, 20 years. So for example, back in 1992, Bilderbergers, for the first time in Evian in France, discussed world army. So that's the concept, which took them about over a decade to actually implement and put into motion. Then in 1996, it became a key issue in Austrian and Finnish European elections. Okay, about a couple of years later, it became a key issue in national elections in Spain. Okay, and before you know it, the BBC and other newspapers around the world are talking about the Europe's rapid reaction force. Okay, and then in 2002, Bilderberg came back and talked about it again, and it was all over the news in the United States, and everybody was saying, well, we have to do something, especially back in the 1990s, we have to do something about all this genocide going on in Kosovo and Yugoslavia, and we have to create something which is going to be, you know, a European version of the United Nations, which is going to be this rapid reaction force. And then before you know it, okay, it becomes the key issue again in European elections, and again a key issue in elections in Spain, and Portugal, and Italy, you know, national elections, where the politicians who belong to Bilderberg, who behold to their interests, bring this up as the key issue in the election debate. And then in 2006, 2 days, this is Thursday, so 4 days after Bilderbergers had finished their meeting in Ottawa, in Canada, what's on the cover of the Toronto Star, which is the key mouthpiece for Bilderbergers in Canada? United Nations Army proposed. It wasn't proposed. It was proposed, you know, 14 years before that in France. It was actually being implemented. It's on the cover of the newspaper. Do you understand how it works? Okay. But because, you know, you have, again, you don't need to control. You're saying, well, if they're so powerful, how many, like, are there millions of these people? No, they're not. You actually don't need to have a lot of people. You just need to have key people in key positions running this thing. Okay, which is why, again, if you have a corporation like Coca-Cola, if you have the guy who's the president and he's a member of Bilderberg and a couple of other people are also members, you know, you don't have to include the, you know, the toilet cleaner as a member of Bilderberg. She's just going to follow orders. And that's how it works. You just get key people in key institutions and everybody works together. And once you're a member of Bilderberg, you're a member for life, meaning that even if you don't attend, you certainly get information. You certainly get access to all of the people who have attended Bilderberg, now, present, past, or future. And again, it's done for a very simple reason, you know, very smart reason. You know, you keep the networking of these people, and you always have access to David Rockefeller, you always have access to Bill Clinton. So if one day you suddenly, you know, wake up one morning and say, you know, I want to be good and do good for the world and bring this information out, they will destroy you. They won't kill you because, you know, most of these people don't know anything. But certainly you'll be cut off from the access of, to this, right? You understand what I'm saying? And another couple of issues, nuclear energy was on the agenda in 2006, and also rethinking the country, you know, what Canada is going to be like in the future was another key issue on the agenda. And here it is on the front page, or pages, of the key periodicals. Now, Will Hutton said back in 97 that no policy is made here, it's all talk. But the consensus established is the backdrop against which the policy is made worldwide, and that's absolutely the case. Now, over the years, okay, as Zbigniew Brzezinski talks about the old framework of international politics with the spheres of influence, the fiction of sovereignty of nation-state republics is clearly no longer compatible with their reality, which is very different from, you know, my reality. And when we talk about blocks, again, it's not about one world order. It's about economic blocks, regions. You have Europe, you have North American Free Trade Agreement, the Asian nations emerging into an Asian Union. You have all these, you know, different organizations, you know, from Africa and Asia, who are actually working, you know, in a very rudimentary, you know, economic unions. But they're all there. It's just a matter of, you know, taking them one step up and merging all these unions as a penultimate step towards merging them in the economic world community. And again, as I said, back in 1968, in a meeting in Montreal, in Canada, George Ball, who was the Undersecretary for Economic Affairs with JFK and Johnson, he basically, you know, said, where does one find a legitimate base for the power of corporate managements to make decisions that can profoundly affect the economic life of nations to whose governments they have only limited responsibility? So the idea is you destroy nation-state republics. And when you destroy nation-state republics, which you basically have, nation-states have given us constitutions, they've given us natural law, has given us social welfare, general welfare. Now, general welfare is not a concept You know, some big fat guy sitting on a couch eating pizza and slobbering all over himself, watching television, collecting government unemployment checks. That was nothing to do with general welfare. The concept, the higher principle of general welfare, spelled out in the preamble of the Constitution of the United States, you know, as natural law. It has a very different meaning. You know, it reaches into our subconscious, talks about, you know, the higher level of consciousness. You know, what is the responsibility of governments to the people? What is the meaning of the word immortality? You know, immortality is not some guy who lives a good life and, you know, dies and his soul goes to heaven. I mean, that's just plain stupid. Bach is immortal because, you know, had it not been Bach, we wouldn't have Beethoven, all right? Beethoven's, Bach's music lives through Beethoven. You know, Dante is immortal not only because he's written amazing, you know, canto, which is Divine Comedy, but also because of him, you have the Renaissance. And because of the Renaissance, because of Dante, you have, you know, the French language, you have the English language, which was developed by Chaucer. You have the Spanish language, and all these languages survived at the worst time, you know, in the history of mankind, you know, the Middle Ages, the, you know, the bubonic plague, the Black Death. Well, the entire European continent was going to hell in a handbasket. And the idea of greater good, what it represents, again, historically, if you put it in perspective, we'll come back to it just, you know, in a couple of minutes. But the idea is of what these people are talking about. You know, you can dissect if you understand historically and intellectually where all this stuff comes from. Now, this is a page I didn't know this. Bill Englund told me yesterday, if he's here, thank you. And over the years, some of the decisions taken at Bilderberg conferences, again, we've called all these things, and my batting average is about, you know, 98%, which, you know, in baseball terms would make me the greatest hitter in the history of mankind. But this is from the 1973 Bilderberg Report. And although you can't see it, where Bill marks a little asterisk, that's his mark, I didn't know it at the time. The Bilderbergers are talking back in May 1973 between pushing the oil price, okay? Somewhere between the end of the second paragraph, you see between 10 and 12.50, sorry, I stepped out of the box again, slap me. Okay, 10 and 12.50 a barrel. Well, you know what, 6 months later, at the end of the year, it goes to 11.65. You know, it's like a coincidence, sure, you know, again. Coincidences in the world of operations, they just don't exist. They're badly planned operations, and they're well-planned operations. And over the years, these are some of the other things. In 1981, the NAFTA, North American Free Trade Agreement, was put into, you know, high gear. What had happened was as soon as Reagan and Bush came into office, the next day they called the, you know, the transnational bankers, who told them America as a nation was bankrupt. Had it been a corporation, would have been, you know, disbanded. So, put into receivership. So they came up with this brilliant plan, merge Canada and the United States into one greater North America and get rid of Quebec, which is a French-speaking part. And they realized it's going to take them about 15 years to get this plan in motion. And in the meantime, they're going to, you know, reorganize the economies, the, you know, the social networks, the, you know, the health plans, et cetera, of both nations to actually merge them into one. You know, and that's how actually I got into Bilderberg, because back in 1992, a friend of my grandfather's was a colonel of KGB counterintelligence. He told me about, you know, these people called Bilder something or other who are going to do these things to Canada 3 years in the future. And I said, this guy's nuts. Well, 1995 came around, and suddenly, you know, Quebec was making, you know, the right noises at the right time, as this man had predicted 3 years earlier. I said to myself, if this is actually true, then who the hell runs the world? Because politicians obviously have nothing to do the way things are done. Okay? So the NAFTA thing was basically literally a banker's reorganizing North America for the benefit of the bottom line. Okay, and if you're interested, because for the sake of, you know, short of time, you can ask me during the break or lunch or dinner or whatever, you know, and I'll explain to you how it was done. In 1990, they ordered Bush to raise taxes. You remember the famous thing, you know, read my lips, no new taxes? Well, nothing to do with, you know, they didn't tell Bush to raise taxes. They just explained it to him by raising taxes and giving it, you know, this money to third world nations, not out of the goodness of their heart, but because they're going to pay back the interest on the monies they owe. You understand what I'm saying? Okay, that's why they raise taxes. Okay, the war in Yugoslavia was first discussed back in 1991, as I called it, the UN Standing Army, okay, and the UN attacks, again, that's another issue was on the agenda. In 1996, war in Kosovo, 3 years before, you know, Jane Intelligence Review, which is a very important magazine, intelligence magazine, you know, I called it about a year and a half before they did, breakup of Canada. In 2002, the war in Iraq, when they met in Chantilly, you know, I even called the month, you know, I said end of February, end of March, you know, that's a year into the future. Because they were terrified, you know, of the upheaval in Europe, for millions of people actually saying no to war, all right? And in 2002, oil, I think, was about $20 a barrel. Well, they said, you know, by the end of 2007, it's going to hit 100. I called that and went to 100 on the 2nd of January, 2008. That's pretty good, you know, if you're talking about getting lucky. And then in 2005, they met in May. Angela Merkel came, and not only did she come, but Gerhard Schroeder, who was the chancellor at the time. You know, both of them at the same meeting. I said, what the, you know, it's, I said, yeah, I know who's going to be the next, you know, leader of Germany a few months later, and of course, it was Merkel. And in 2005, they talked about pushing the oil up to about $150 a barrel by, you know, late summer 2008. You may not believe them, but it's like if you go to the internet, it's all over the place. My predictions are all over there, videos on YouTube, et cetera. You know, it hit 147.5 exactly what it's supposed to, and then it went right down to 30. You remember that? I called that too. And the reason it went up and then it went down, because you see, these people have two enemies, China and Russia. There's no other enemy. So China has no oil. So you can actually push the price up to, you know, to 150. Anything that's made is made with, you know, for now, with cheap oil. So if you do that, you're taking money out of their hands and you're destroying their economy. The Russians have a lot of oil to go around. If you can actually push the price down to nothing, which is how they destroyed the Soviet Union back in the 1980s, that and the, you know, mini nuclear explosion, which was set up by the Americans in Chernobyl. But the point is, that's how you destroy a country, okay? By push the oil price down to nothing, so their, you know, main good, you can't sell it for a lot of money, which is why it went down to 30, all right? And in 2006, I called exactly the month of the melting, you know, housing meltdown in the United States, and especially in Spain. And how are we doing for time, by the way, out of curiosity? Probably not very good. I got 20 minutes. God bless you. Thank you. I want to talk a little bit about the control of the media. Now, how many of you have a television set? Nobody. Okay. It's like, I read books, you know. Okay. Those of you who don't have a television set, how many of you have two television sets? Three television sets, four television sets, one that does, you know, rotate every time you move so you don't lose anything, you know. The greatest form of control is when you think you're free while you're being, you know, dictated to. There's two forms of dictatorship. One form of dictatorship is, you know, when you think you're free, while it's actually, yeah, being, you know, in prison, and you can actually, you know, feel the bars. But another much more subtle form of dictatorship is actually when you think you're free and you don't see the bars, but they're there. And as I said, the biggest hypnotist in the world is that oblong tube. Not you, other people, you know, have in the living room of their houses. And it basically tells them what to do. And what they, you know, the man behind the curtain, the shadow masters, the Bilderbergers, what they've been able to do over the years is they persuaded us that if you believe what you see is what's there to see, or what you read in the front page of the newspaper is what's there to read, the truth, you know, then they negate the ultimate truth, which is, you know, they'll laugh in your face when you tell them the things I'm telling you right now, because they've been, you know, hypnotized into believing that there's only one reality. And the danger of that, of course, is that you're fighting an enemy, which is, you know, very, very difficult to fight. Because the majority's perception of reality is not their own. It's been very shrewdly imposed upon them by the man behind the curtain. Let me give you a couple of examples. And again, the idea is here is to understand the whole concept of critical thinking. The war in Afghanistan, it's the drug war. It's nothing to do about bringing democracy, you know, to these godforsaken, you know, goat-smelling, you know, farmers. These people have never had known democracy for as long as you Afghanistan or Afghanistan. You see, what happened in 1996, talking about the drug trade, when the Taliban came into power, the first thing they did was they just, you know, wiped out the anapolis, you know, the opium. And literally overnight, they took out $40 billion, okay, in hard cash out of the world financial system, okay? Now, 8 months later, which is, you know, the period of time it takes for that drug money to wash into the, you know, financial mainstream, okay? You had the Asian nations, you know, the Asian crisis, financial crisis, all the Asian tigers, you know, their economy is being destroyed. And of course, the United States suddenly found that, you know, they didn't have enough cash. And the reason for that, the Taliban, who don't have a nuclear warhead to go on, what they do have is, you know, the ability to take the money out of the financial system. Because that money, again, washes itself through Wall Street. And Today, NATO controls more than 90% of the country, and you have the biggest crop of of drugs coming out of that country in the history of mankind. You know that, right? You've read that somewhere, right? Well, see, there's a there's a correlation. It's not a coincidence. There's a correlation between these two events. Okay, and the correlation is that NATO is not there, to wipe out the Taliban or eliminate the drug trade. They're there to make sure the drug trade flourishes because they need that cash, because the financial system has no liquid capital. Zero, it's just nothing, what's keeping it afloat is the drug money, which is one of the reasons you have the biggest, drug crop in the world this year. And if you ask yourselves, how is that possible, in a country where, you have all these, most sophisticated weapons in the world trained on Afghanistan, how can they find, the drugs to actually eliminate them? Well, they can, it's the plan is not to eliminate, it's actually get them onto the markets so they can prop up the financial system. That's one example. Another example, do you remember back in September 2005, the famous Mohammed or Mahoma cartoons from JP Politik, and I have there's somebody from Denmark here, I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. Do you guys remember the famous cartoons? Where these Danish newspaper media group portrayed Muslims as, literally overnight, you have, 4 million Muslims protesting from, if you look at the map of the world, from Morocco to Indonesia, that's a pretty big swath of land, especially if you have to walk across. Now, I don't have a television set. As a matter of fact, I've never had a television set. As a small child, 6-year-old, I was watching this guy on television in the Soviet Union, and I'd look for him behind, and I'd say, he's not there. It's like, I couldn't explain it any other way, but I said, this is a lie. I can explain it today much better, but, the concept hasn't changed. So when I was watching this on television, these Muslims from around the world protesting and burning. Do you remember they were burning Danish flags? 4 million people burning Danish flags. I had just one question, and all these people were saying, these guys, they're Osama bin Laden supporters, the Al-Qaedists, the terrorists, they're extremists. I was sitting in a bar in Madrid. I was looking at the screen, I said to myself, where the fuck did 4 million people get a Danish flag from? Now, again, because, I always got a 5 in psychology, and out of 5, and my brain works fairly well. It's like if you can answer that question, the rest becomes really academic. It has nothing to do with anything else. But I'm sure you never saw on the cover of any newspaper in the world this particular question. Because if you analyze the deeper meaning of this, you suddenly understand how much technology and workmanship, okay, and effort and organization has to go into this particular event to get 4 million people around a very large path of earth to do this so they can actually project the images on television so a big fat, slob in New York eating his potato sandwich can see this and say, yeah, these guys, they want to kill us for our freedom. You understand that? Because, think about this. You want to get a Danish flag. Okay, so we can steal one from the embassy. We can steal one from the consulate. That's two. We still need about, 3,999,998 flags. Well, I don't know. Maybe you get a Quran, you get a Danish flag. They just might have gotten lucky. We'll figure it out. But I don't think so. So somebody had to actually come around to all these groups, regional, local groups. If anywhere you're in local politics, you know how hard it is to get anybody to do anything together. And you get all these people, they all have Danish flags, they're all burning this goddamn, there's people who wear, towels and beach sandals for clothes, they all got Danish flags. You have a birthday party, you invite 100 people because they love you, 30 come, they don't come at the same time, they come early, late, they come drunk, they all, and you want to believe, they want us to believe that you get all these people across the world coming out simultaneously at 3:55 p.m., and start waving this goddamn flag. Come on, man. Have any of you ever asked yourselves this particular question about the flag? Good for you. And the point is that if you can answer that question, all right, you're critically thinking. And that's my whole point. You have to understand, you have to go beyond what's actually being presented to you. You see, people who try to create empires, they do so by manipulating the people they try to conquer. And talking about... I've got to go very quickly through this particular part. Who runs the media and, some of the American left-keeping gatekeeper community. If you look at some of these media groups, the Pacifica, The Nation. These are some of the leading, you know, darlings of America's alternative media, and PBS, of course, as well. You look at, they get their funding from the, you know, from the Soros, from the Carlyle Group, from the CIA, you know, from the Ford Foundation, you know, FAIR, which is a very important journal, magazine, mouthpiece, you know, for the left gatekeepers. They get their money, you know, from the Rockefellers, the CIA, the Council on Foreign Relations, the Ford Foundation, the Trilateral Commission, and the Skull and Bones, all right, which is the American, literally American representative of the Illuminati, because the Illuminati had given them a letter saying that you can open the American branch, and they call themselves Skull and Bones. So do you think FAIR will be fair in their reporting when it comes to actually reporting the real events? I don't think so, exactly. And the way it's done this way, the reason is that, so you don't get in the way of important people, okay, by doing too much thinking on your own, which is why you get all this variety of entertainment, you know, thrown at you so that you get lost. You know, even Google and even internet, there's just so much crap out there. So unless you're discerning, unless you really understand, you know, you really, really do get lost. 62% of information comes from the television. There's a, you know, the only truth that most people know is what they get from the television. There's an entire generation of people out there who never seen anything, never known anything that didn't come out of that tube. 5% of Americans, I imagine it's 5%, you know, across the world, have read more than 5 books per year. Yet 1 billion people watch the Oscar Awards, and 1 billion people watch the final of the World Cup football championship. All right? Now, this tube, the television, has become the gospel, you know, the ultimate revelation. It can break presidents and prime ministers. It can put Jesus, make a believer out of Jesus if it had to. And what basically happens when these corporations hold the media groups, hold the money cartels, hold the banks, they tell you any truth they want, and they manipulate the reality any way they want. Unless you understand what's behind this reality, it's very, very difficult. It's very easy to get lost. It's very difficult to understand, you know, which way you should be actually looking. So, you know, all the American corporations, the NBC, the CBS, the ABC, if you look at the list of people, they're all trilateral, all Bilderberg, they're all Council on Foreign Relations. So you actually never get anything out of these people. We just get an offer from 60 Minutes to do an interview with the main character of my new book, who is in prison in Bangkok. Well, 60 Minutes, if you look actually at the list, you know, not only are they Bilderberg CFR, but they're also, you know, they're the people who funded CBS. You know, they're funded Nazis back in the 1920s and 1930s. So do you think I will get fair shake out of these people's 60 Minutes? I don't think so. You know, I got a letter a couple of days ago, you know, from a reader. Do you know PBS, American Channel PBS? Did you get it in England? You don't. Well, anyway, you know what it is. It's you know, it's probably the most, you know, loved channel in America. This guy says, you wrote in your book about PBS, and I've enjoyed a lot of great programming over the years, like from, you know, John Denver, Gary Franchi, of whoever the hell he is, of Restore the Republic, that supports the same fight, the corruption in the New World Order that you do, and in fact, someone I have known for years. You said AT&T funded most of PBS, and actually it's a nonprofit organization that is supported by viewers like ourselves. You cannot say that original intention is to support. Yes, I can, because I can prove it, you know. I can say that, you see, I can. Okay, this is PBS, all right? The cornerstone of PBS's programming is the News Hour of Jim Lear, which is like the most important program in America in news. Now, Jim Lear is a member of Council of Foreign Relations, which is the American version of Bilderbergers, okay? Now, the PBS foundings, you know, they come from AT&T, which is a CFR company, Archer Daniels Midland, all right, whose chairman, Dwayne Andrews, is a member of the Trilateral Commission. Pepsi Cola, who's member Indra Nui, you saw her pictures, member of Bilderberg, as well as Trilateral Commission. Okay, and Smith Barney, which is one of the world's leading financial institutions. That's another CFR company. Now, Smith Barney is interlocked with Citigroup, all right? And the journalists in the News Hour with Jim Lear, Paul Gigot, David Gergen, William Kristol, William Sapphire, all Pulitzer Prize-winning reporters, they're all members of Bilderberg, they're all members of the Trilateral Commission, they're all members of Council on Foreign Relations. So it comes time to talk about the destruction of nation-state republics, as Brzezinski was talking about, and changing the American Constitution so you can actually eliminate anything that has to do with, you know, what's written in the preamble to the Constitution and the basic rights, you know, the general welfare. Do you think these people are going to be in the front lines reporting it? I don't think so. You know, so yes, I can say PBS does all these things because I can show it. And when we're talking against, I'm just going to give you one example how all these corporations are interlocked. And after this, we're going to go into the Venetian black nobility and we'll finish because I know we're running short of time. Okay? An example, just one example of how this is, again, this is this giant juggernaut. This is, it's a very dynamic system. You know, that changes with the times. It absorbs and creates new parts while excretes the remaining of the worn out and decaying parts. Members come and go, but the system itself, all right, of all these corporations hasn't changed. It is a self-perpetuating system, a virtual spider web of interlocked financial, political, economic, and industry interests with a Venetian ultramontane Fondi model at the center. So let's look at an example of Lazard. We talked about Lazard Ferries before, a very important financial corporations, and of course Lazard is also behind the Nazis back in the 20s and the 30s. It's Lazard's major client is Royal Dutch Shell, which is a combination of the British and the Dutch petroleum interests. Now, if you look at the board of directors of the corporations that sit on the board of directors of Royal Dutch Shell, you have ING, you have ExxonMobil, you have Unilever, Rio Tinto, Boeing, Lloyd's, AXA Insurance, and UBS. All right? And on the board of directors of British Petroleum, you have Royal Bank of Scotland, you have Bank of Hong Kong and Shanghai, the biggest, you know, drug laundering bank in the world, the second one is Citibank. Okay, you have Roche, you have Goldman Sachs, you have Rolls-Royce, General Electric, Bank of America, KPMG, and GlaxoSmithKline, which is a pharmaceutical company. All right. Now, if you go one step further, all right, Bank of Hong Kong and Shanghai, on its board, it's interlocked. You know, you sit Shell, Anglo American, which is a gold producer. You have Financial Times, The Economist. Both of these people are Bilderberg members. You have Imperial Chemical Industries, Glaxo, Rolls-Royce, and Kleinwort Trust, which is a very, very important corporation, okay, through parent company Dresden, which is a an investment bank, okay. You have on their board of directors, you have Goldman Sachs, which shares directors with Bank of Hong Kong and Shanghai, and Royal Bank of Scotland, and then in it's, you know, Royal Bank of Scotland has BP, Goldman Sachs, Lloyd's. Do you see what I'm saying? All right, nobody leaves. It's a juggernaut. It's everybody. It sits together. Nobody leaves, and if they try to leave, they're destroyed. Like, nobody kills anybody, nobody tells anybody what to do, but everybody understands that you can manipulate financial markets, just like manipulate anything in the world, especially if you control the, you know, the levers of how the system works. So you can actually do this, okay? I want to talk about the what's, again, Bilderberger's roots, which is the Venetian black nobility. And again, what today is called Bilderberg, 800 years ago, was called Venetian black nobility. And as a point of departure, what we do is we have to find that period in history that separates modern from medieval. And modern history supersedes medieval. That point in history where the institutions were, you know, modern institutions were put into existence. And that occurred, as I said a few minutes ago, back in 1439, 1440, as a result of a meeting which was called Council of Florence between Nicholas of Cusa, Cardinal Nicholas of Cusa, future Pope Pius II, all right, and Patriarch Isidore representing the Greek Orthodox Church. And these forces temporarily merging the Eastern and Western rites of the Christian Church, all right. And as a result of that, 20 years later, see what we had in France under Louis XI, was the first nation state republic on earth, which became possible as a result of the financial meltdown a century before that in 1345, which put the favorable conditions, which after fermenting for a while, gave rise to first the nation state, the idea of nation states in Council of Florence, and then to the first nation state in France, which has given us constitution, which has given us natural law, which has given us general welfare, all right? And as a second condition, it has given us the a mandate, all right, given to the Republic by the people to continue on the road to scientific and technological development. And that alone changed the equation, you know, for how things were to be done from that point on into the future. Because you see, any advancements in politics and science and in anything affected every other nation in Europe because nobody could afford to be left behind. Even the Venetian black nobility, which at that point was getting ready to take over England, you know, through William of Orange. Still, you know, everybody had to follow suit. Otherwise, they'd be left hopelessly behind, which is one of the reasons why, and of course, the second nation state was in, the idea of nation state was in England with Henry VII. And the idea, you see, was that France, from the 1460s up until 1815, when Napoleon was finally destroyed, was the most important nation in the world, economically, financially, spiritually, scientifically, because what it had done in the previous centuries has affected, you know, literally the all the nations of the world. And so what the English had done, when I say the English, I mean the Venetian black nobility, which by that time had taken over England, they created Napoleon. And they created Napoleon, again, Napoleon wasn't their dupe, but they just figured him out, all right? They just knew exactly what he was like. You know, they knew that in any time of crisis, he would, you know, self-destruct, which is exactly what happened. So what they had done is they created the Austrian army to give Napoleon his greatest victories, okay? Because you see, what had happened was, before Napoleonic Wars, you had one, France only had one enemy, which is Great Britain. And after Napoleon was dead, you had the entire continent of Europe against France, and France was destroyed. So you had the greatest nation state on earth destroyed, all right, wiped out by these gangsters. You know, the same gangsters who wiped out the achievements of Charlemagne way, way back when. So again, the you know, these two ideas, the nation state and the scientific and technological progress, they represented a crucial argument that their existence as institutions in any part of Europe literally affected, you know, lives of people across the continent. And this is what's behind this ferocious conflict which has been raging for the past 650 years between the followers, okay, of Nicholas of Cusa and the degenerates, you know, leading the fight on the other side. And actually, if you look at it in historical terms, it's a very, very old fight. It's about, you know, it's a fight between the classical culture and the followers of the Enlightenment movement. You have the, on one side, you know, we're standing on, you know, some pretty big people on our side. Solon, Plato, Socrates, Leonardo da Vinci, Nicolas of Cusa, Raphael Sanzio, Veronese, Leibniz, Schiller, Shelley, you know. And you have the degenerates on the other side, the Aristotle, the Bertrand Russells and company. But, you know, we're doing pretty good, pretty well. We got some really big people on our side. So, again, the, and actually, you know, speaking of greatness, we also have people like Christopher Marlowe, who's a great playwright. And I found, I spent 2.5 years researching in the National Library in Florence, and I found amazing documents signed in 1590 by Paolo Sarpi, which is today's David Rockefeller. They were actually talking about killing Marlowe, which he was killed in 1593, 3 years later, and I found actual document. I couldn't take it out because you can't take anything out of the National Library of Florence, of the archives. But I found the document, we're talking in old Italian, of killing Marlowe, because what he had done in his place, Fausto, he actually, you know, talked about the Venetian takeover in England. They didn't have televisions in those, at least I don't think they had televisions in those days, okay? So what he was basically telling you was the front page news, and they killed the man. So you can find this kind of information, 90% is available, it's at the fingertips. It's just a question of actually knowing where to look. You see, and with this, I'm gonna end. The development of mankind, the development of the power of the individual and of the nation, depends upon scientific developments which are used to increase the power of men over nature. Okay, it's, you know, the power is not the power of money, which, you know, money has no intrinsic value. Okay, what separates us from animals is our ability to discover universal principles of nature. All right, we can actually make life better for the planet. That's what, you know, the founding fathers of the American Republic, that's what they meant by general welfare, all right? It's not some guy collecting unemployment checks. It's about the concept of immortality. It's about us leaving something for future generations. You know, that means, you know, colonizing space, colonizing moon, colonizing Mars, making sure that the future generations live in a better world, all right? You know, the empire of money, the empire of usury, they don't want progress, which is why you have zero growth. The concepts of zero growth, you have to understand where these things come from, okay? Because if you have wealthier families, you have greater population base. See, our greatest resource is not oil or natural gas, or it's the minds of the people. When you have 6.7 billion people on the planet working together towards a common good, all right, for future generations, that's what immortality is. And that's why Bach is immortal, okay? And that's why Leibniz is immortal, and that's why Leonardo da Vinci is immortal. And that's why, you know, people who aspire to greatness, you know, in the future, you know, their concept of immortality has nothing to do with some guy living, dying, and his soul going to heaven. That's not immortality. Of course, the, you know, empire or globalization, which is just another word of empire, You know, they don't want any kind of development of human spirit. And what separates us, again, from animals is our ability to, you know, create scientific principles. And the empire, of course, of money depends upon the suppression of scientific development and knowledge by keeping us backwards and dumb. It's concept of immortality, and I just written it this morning, it's a mission. We're willing to stake our lives for that mission, whatever that mission may be. And this also means having a conscience. It's a connection to a sense of principle of what we're willing to do to spend our lives on, you know, to achieve this better good for humanity's future. And if we do this, you know, we're untouchable and we are immortal, because nothing that these people can do to us can hurt us, because there's 6.7 billion of us. And I think that happiness lies in the joy of achievement and in the thrill of creative efforts. And this is what Bilderbergers are so much afraid of. That's why they want us dumb us down, because they're terrified of what we as people can do as nation states, independent nation states in the world. And I'm going to stop here again. Thank you so much for being here. I hope you enjoyed what I said. And we'll be talking about it soon.
Daniel Estulin.
Thank you very much.
Stuff.